Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Dear students, today the topic of our discussion is cholera, which is a communicable intestinal infection. Cholera is an acute diarrheal disease which is caused by Vibrio cholerae O1 and O139 strains. Cases, they range from symptomless to severe infections. The majority of the infections, they are mild or asymptomatic. The typical cases of cholera, they are characterized by sudden onset of profuse, effortless watery diarrhea, which is followed by vomiting, rapid dehydration, muscular cramps, and suppression of urine. In cholera, dehydration is very marked. Unless there is rapid replacement of fluid and electrolytes, the case fatality may be as high as 30 to 40%. Cholera is a global threat to public health, and it is a key indicator of lack of social development. Cholera transmission is closely linked to inadequate environmental management. The typical at-risk areas include peri-urban areas where basic infrastructure is not available, and in areas where, as a consequence of disaster, there is disruption of water supply and sanitation. The true burden of the disease is estimated to be around 1.4 to 4.3 million cases and 28,000 to 142,000 deaths annually. However, many cases, they are unaccounted for because of the limitations in the surveillance systems and fear of trade and travel sanctions. Recent studies, they have indicated that the global warming is creating a favorable environment for the spread of this bacteria. Dear students, now we will discuss the epidemiological determinants of cholera. First of all, we will discuss the agent factors. There are many different strains of Vibrios. However, the organism that causes the cholera is labeled as Vibrio cholerae O1 and Vibrio cholerae O139. These are the strains which have also been labeled as the epidemic strains because they are responsible for the epidemic of cholera. This bacteria excretes the exotoxin in the small intestine, and this produces the diarrhea. It does not affect any other tissue other than the intestinal epithelial cells. The resistance of this bacteria, it is rapidly killed by heating within 30 minutes at 56 centigrade or within few seconds by boiling. Drying and sunshine also kill them in few hours. They are readily destroyed by cold tar disinfectants such as Crisol. Bleaching powder is another good powerful disinfectant. Reservoir of infection. The human being is the only known reservoir. It may be a case or a carrier. The cases, they generally range from inapparent infection to severe ones. A vast majority of people which are infected with Vibrio cholerae, about 75%, they don't develop any symptoms, and the bacteria is present in their feces for about 7 to 14 days after being infected, and they shed the organism in the environment, and they potentially act as a source of infection to other people. The people who got weak immunity, that is, they are suffering from HIV, malnourished children, that they are at greater risk of death. The carriers, they are usually temporary and sometimes chronic. Carriers, they contribute an important contribution to the reservoir of infection. However, the carriers excrete few Vibrios than the clinical cases. Now, the infective material. Stool and vomit of the cases and carriers, they are the infective material. Infective dose. Cholera is dose related. Infection occurs when the number of vibrios ingested they exceed the dose that is effective for that particular individual. Period of communicability. A case of cholera is infectious for a period of 7 to 10 days. Convalescent carriers, they are infectious for 2 to 3 weeks, and the chronic carrier state may last from a month up to 10 years or more. Now we will discuss the host factors. Cholera affects all ages and both sexes. However, the attack rate is highest in children in endemic areas. Gastric acidity, it provides an effective barrier. The vibrio is destroyed in an acidity of pH 5 or lower. So the conditions that reduce the gastric acidity may influence the individual susceptibility. Population mobility. Movements of the population, as in case of large festivals, gatherings, they result in an increased risk of exposure to infection. Economic status. Generally, this disease occurs in people belonging to lower socioeconomic status and the people who are having the poor hygiene, especially as already discussed earlier, in the peri-urban areas and in the slum areas. Immunity. An attack of cholera is followed by immunity to reinfection, but unfortunately the duration of the immunity and the degree of immunity is not known. Vaccination is there, but vaccination gives you only temporary protection and partial immunity only for 3 to 6 months. Environmental factors, they play an important role in the spread of cholera. Vibrio transmission is readily possible in a community with poor environmental sanitation. The environmental factors of importance include contaminated water and food supply, low standards of personal hygiene, lack of education, and poor quality of life. They are the important predisposing factors for the spread of cholera. Transmission of cholera occurs from man to man via three modes: fecally contaminated water, contaminated food and drinks, and direct contact. In case of fecally contaminated water, uncontrolled water resources such as wells, lakes, ponds, streams, and rivers, they pose a great threat. Contaminated food and drinks, fruits and vegetables which are washed with contaminated water, they can be a source of infection. Bottle feeding can also pose a significant risk for the infants. In addition, after the food is prepared, the cooked food may be contaminated through contaminated hands and flies. Direct contact, person-to-person transmission through contaminated fingers may occur while carelessly handling the excreta and vomit of patients and via contaminated linens and fomites. The incubation period of this disease may be short, from a few hours up to 5 days, but commonly it is around 1 to 2 days. Now we will discuss the clinical features of cholera. The main symptom of cholera is diarrhea. The severity of cholera is basically dependent on the rapidity and duration of fluid loss. While discussing the clinical features, the three stages they have been recognized. That is the stage of evacuation, stage of collapse, and stage of recovery. The first stage is stage of evacuation. In it, the onset is abrupt, with profuse, painless, effortless watery diarrhea, which is followed by vomiting. The patient may pass as many stools as 40 in a day. The stools, they give rise to a characteristic appearance which is given the name rice water appearance. Then comes the stage of collapse. This stage is characterized by sunken eyes, hollow cheeks, scarified abdomen, subnormal temperature, washerman's hand and feet, absent pulse, unrecordable blood pressure, loss of skin elasticity, shallow and quick respirations, and because of dehydration, the output of urine decreases, and if severe dehydration is there, it may ultimately stop. The patient becomes restless and complains of intense thirst because of dehydration and cramps in legs and abdomen. Death may occur at this stage because of dehydration and acidosis, which result from diarrhea. Now we will discuss the last stage, that is stage of recovery. If the death does not occur, the patient begins to show signs of clinical improvement. That is, the blood pressure begins to rise, the temperature returns to normal, and the urine secretion is re-established. The classical form of severe diarrhea basically occurs only in 5 to 10% of the cases. In the rest, the disease tends to be mild, which is characterized by diarrhea with or without vomiting or marked dehydration. As a rule, mild cases recover in 1 to 3 days. Dear students, this slide is showing you the different signs and symptoms of cholera, which we discussed earlier. These are diarrhea, rapid weight loss, increased thirst, vomiting, low blood pressure because of dehydration, and loss of skin elasticity. The following preventive and control measures, they are based on the guidelines for the cholera control as proposed by World Health Organization. The first is verification of diagnosis. It is important to have the confirmation of the outbreak as quickly as possible. All the cases of diarrhea should be investigated, and it is important to isolate the bacteria from the stool of the patient. Once it is confirmed that the cholera is there, then it is not necessary to culture the stool samples of all the cases. Then the notification. Cholera is a notifiable disease locally and nationally. Early case finding. An aggressive search for the cases, whether they are mild, moderate or severe, should be made in the community in order to initiate the appropriate treatment. Establishment of treatment centers. The mild dehydrated patients, which account for more than 90% of the cases, should be treated at home with ORS. However, the severely dehydrated patients, which require intravenous fluids, should be transferred to the nearest hospital, or if there is no nearby health facilities there, then the school building can be used. Rehydration therapy. In it, ORS solution should be given, and if the patient is vomiting and cannot take the orally, then the intravenous rehydration should be started. Adjuncts to therapy. Antibiotics should be given as soon as the vomiting is stopped, which is usually given after 3 to 4 hours of oral rehydration. Injectable antibiotics, they don't have special advantages over the oral one. The commonly used antibiotics for this include fluoroquinolones, tetracycline, azithromycin, and trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole. Epidemiological investigations. Epidemiological studies must be undertaken to define the extent of the outbreak and identify the modes of transmission, so that the more effective and specific control measures they can be applied. Sanitation measures. Sanitation measures, they are very important. These include water control, excreta disposal, food sanitation, and disinfection. As water is the most important vehicle of transmission of cholera, so all the steps must be taken to provide properly treated water. In urban areas, properly treated drinking water containing the free residual chlorine should be made available to all the families. While in rural areas, water can be made safe by either boiling or by chlorination. Excreta disposal. Provision of simple, cheap, and effective excreta disposal system is a basic need of all human settlements. Human excreta should be properly disposed of, and it should be away from the source of water. Food sanitation. Food sanitation is very important because food is an important vehicle of infection. So steps should be taken to improve the food sanitation. Particularly, the sale of food should be done under hygienic condition, and health education of the food handlers should be done. Disinfection. Various disinfection methods can be adopted. The simple and the most effective method of disinfection is called a disinfectant. In addition, bleaching powder can also be used. Chemoprophylaxis. Chemoprophylaxis generally is recommended for only household contacts or of a closed community in which the cholera has occurred. Generally, tetracycline is the drug of choice. Deoxycycline can also be used. And the vaccination. There are two types of vaccines that are available: the Ducoral vaccine and Sanquol and MORCVAX vaccine. Both of these are oral vaccine. Ducoral is not licensed for children less than 2 years of age, and in it, two oral doses, they should be given more than 7 days apart, and it is a monovalent vaccine containing only the Vibrio cholerae O1. While the other vaccine, Sanquol vaccine, it is a bivalent oral vaccine containing O1 and O139, and it is licensed for children greater than 1 year of age, and the two doses should be given 14 days apart. The last measure is health education. Perhaps the most effective prophylactic measure is health education. It should be directed mainly to the effectiveness and simplicity of oral rehydration therapy, the benefits of early reporting for prompt treatment, the food hygienic practices, hand washing after defecation and before eating, and the benefits of cooked hot foods and safe water. Since cholera is mainly a disease of the poor and the ignorant group, these groups should be tackled first. On this slide, there is a picture which is showing you the different preventive and control measures of cholera, which we have already discussed. This slide is showing you another picture describing the different preventive and control measures of cholera. It is basically stressing the importance of using safe drinking water, cleaning hands, eating properly cooked food, and vaccination. This concludes our today's lecture. Thank you very much.